the first indication of prophethood, as Aisha says. The second thing she says, وَحُبِّبَ إِلَيْهِ خَلْوَةً, and it was made beloved to him to be alone. So it's a very interesting choice of words. It was made beloved to him. In another narration she says, وَحَبَّبَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى إِلَيْهِ الْخَلْوَةً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made beloved to him to be alone, solitude. As he was increasingly discontent with the society around him, he wanted to be alone, to ponder the meaning behind his suffering and his tyranny that was engulfing and drenching society around him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made beloved to him to be alone, solitude. It wasn't something out of his own accord. That wasn't his norm. But he, so I said, wanted increasingly more and more, as and she says, nothing was more beloved to him than solitude, to be alone, to contemplate, to meditate over the creation of the heavens and the earth, the falsehood that surrounded him, all the deviances and the oppression from the spirituality and the false idols and the oppression of the people that you already heard about and the subjugation and everything that we just mentioned. And it was in that situation, as he increasingly spent more and more time alone, and he would go to a place slightly outside of Mecca, to a cave, as I'm sure many people already know, called Hira. And in there he would spend his days meditating. And he'd have some meager subsistence, some food and drink. And when it would run out, he would go back home to Mecca, to the city, and stock up, see if his family needed anything, and then he'd return for days at a time. And I know a lot of people, they know the story, or they may have heard details about it. The story about Gabriel alayhissalam coming down with an initial revelation. But before we get to that, before we say that story that I'm sure once again a lot of people know, I want us to focus on something else here. Another point in the middle of all this. Before we talk about the physical story of revelation and what exactly happened and Gabriel alayhissalam saying, recite, I'm not a reciter, the story that many of us already know. Just to contemplate the gravity about what's about to happen to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The seriousness of this issue and what it means to me and you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, God, the creator of the heavens and the earth and everything in between. The creator of me and you, our sustainer, our provider. He chose this instance to send you a letter. He wanted to say something to mankind. Have you ever seen those videos where they show the earth and they zoom out and then how small the earth is and some other planets and then they go to other stars and they keep going until you really don't follow anymore, but the point is they're really small? Who's seen that video? So we're not that significant, right, in the universe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not harmed or benefited by any of us or anything in all existence, by its righteousness or its wickedness or its obedience or disobedience. It's irrelevant to him subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of how he is benefited or harmed. What he gains or loses is nothing. But he chose that instance to send us a letter nonetheless. You're on your way home, inshallah, in a couple hours, and you're driving with your family, and you're pulling up into your driveway, and you're asking the family or whoever you came with, or contemplating to yourself, about the topics of tonight, and the food was okay, the speakers were pretty good except that one guy. And as you walk to your doorstep, you habitually check the mail. In it is, Con Edison, gotta turn off the heat, it's April. And then there's IRS, how they keep finding me. And then there's a letter addressed from the Queen of England. And it's probably fake, it often is, right? She doesn't write to me anymore. But the idea is, it is addressed from the Queen of England to your name. Even if you know what it's fake, how do you feel? You just wonder, why would someone use her name? If it is real and has been sealed and, whatever way that you can tell it's from the Queen of England, I'm not really sure. If it is real, how would you feel? Special. This means Saj definitely feels special, right? No one writes letters anymore, period, so that's definitely special. But even if it was fake, if I had the Queen of England's name on it, or Donald Trump, or any president of any country, or the General Secretary of the UN, someone important, it means something. You would not open that letter feeling the same, none of us would. So, once again, all these things at once, think about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the creator of me and you, he chose at this moment to send us a personalized letter, to tell us something, not just anything. To say subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I care for you. That I want you to be okay. In a meaning and in an intention more than any human being can ever muster or think of or mean or do. That he wants subhanahu wa ta'ala to say, I want to advise you. That the way you're doing it as a whole, as a humanity, is not right. It's not okay. You will not be fine. And I want nothing more than for you to be fine. To be okay. That you're seeking happiness and comfort in this world and you're not heading down the right path. And I'll tell you what that is. Because I know it better than anyone. I'm the only one who knows it, right? That he wanted to tell us, you're seeking food and drink and shelter, and I'm going to tell you where that can be found greater than anywhere else. That everything you wanted is here and so much more. That there are people out there that don't mean the best for you. That they're harming you day and night, and I'll tell you how to be safe. That more than anything, I'll tell you how to fill that hole in your heart, to follow that road, that the end of it is what we find at the end of it. That you find me, subhanahu wa ta'ala. More than anything, does anyone want anything else? Isn't that why we're all here? Isn't that the fundamental purpose of life? Where we came from, what are we doing here, and where are we going? Isn't that what drives human interactions and is behind so much of what we do and don't do? So he sent us a letter to say, here it is. This is what you've been looking for. And I've sent plenty of letters. And I've done so much already that this is just one more, an extra one. So you can make sure to find your way so that you can complete that mission. So you can fulfill and be content and be happy. Even though, once again, he needs none of it, he benefits nothing whatsoever. And if this wasn't achieved and the entirety of us said no, no thank you, not interested, he would not be harmed in the least. But he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. We have honored the children of Adam. And oftentimes we don't honor and respect ourselves. But this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most honorable, the bestower of all honor. So it was in that moment in Ramadan, while the Prophet ﷺ was in solitude, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, the most benevolent, the most loving, the most compassionate, he chose to send the best of angels, Jibreel alayhi salam, the archangel Gabriel, to come down in the best of months, in the month of Ramadan, the ninth month of the Islamic calendar, the holy month, on the best of nights, Laylatul Qadr, the best night of Ramadan, in the best of lands, in Mecca, the holiest of places, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most sacred, made sacred. To the best of people, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most honest, the most sincere, the leader of the prophets, and to relate to him and reveal to him the best of words, the best of our relation, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, the Quran, the noble recitation and revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once again, the purpose of that was the well-being of humanity, was everything that we're seeking and more. What's the runtime, inshallah? Does someone throw something? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, once again, the intention behind this was the well-being of humanity. That's why he told us, فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدَى فَمَنِ اتَّبَعَ هُدَى فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى. That when there comes from you, from me to you, guidance, then whoever follows that guidance, then he will never, or she will never, go astray, be misguided, or suffer any wickedness. And another verse, he says, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. So there will be no fear upon these people, nor shall they grieve. This is the purpose behind the revelation. To fulfill our own purpose. To avoid that suffering and that grieving that will naturally befall anyone who turns away, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَمْ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. Whoever turns away from our revelation, then they will have a lonely life, a depressing life. It won't be fulfilled. They won't find the purpose. Those questions won't be answered. They will not be fulfilled here or in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes for nothing more than for us to be fulfilled in both worlds. So this is where we come to the story that, once again, most people know, that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in solitude, contemplating the creation of heavens and the earth, the purpose of existence, these questions that nag at every single human being's heart, that poke at their conscience that need to be answered for life to be fulfilled. And in the middle of that, he subhanahu wa ta'ala, there came to him the angel Gabriel. The archangel Gabriel. And he came to him with this revelation that we know. The beginning of this revelation, the Quran. And he came to him in the form of a human being. And he appeared to him suddenly, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was shocked. He didn't hear anyone come up the mountain. This is not someone that he knew or seen before. And the first thing he told him was what? Recite, iqra. So he told him, he responded, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what? Ma'ana bi, I do not read, because iqra could mean read or recite. So he understood it to mean read. Iqra. And he said, ma'ana bi, I do not read. He was illiterate. He was unlettered, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a majority of that society was. They did not learn how to read or write. A very small percentage of that society and the world at that time knew how to read or write. So he sallam, then says, Aisha tells us the story that he says he was then squeezed by this man, hugged by him completely. He jumped on top of him and he squeezed him, hatta balagha minni al-jadd, until I was about to pass out. Completely exhausting, not a normal squeeze or a hug. Till the Prophet sallam, said in one narration, I thought I was going to die. And he let go of him. And he said again, what? Iqra, read. So he responded the same thing. Ma'ana bi-qara, I do not read. I'm unlettered. So the man did the same exact thing, squeezed him until he thought he was going to die. And for the third time he says, iqra, read. And he says, the same response, ma'ana bi-qara, I do not read. So then he recites to him, because what he meant was recite, not read. And he tells them the beginning of this divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that will literally change the world. The beginning of that message, that letter that we spoke about a few minutes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Khalaqal insana min 'alaq. Iqra wa rabbukal akram. Alladhi 'allama bil qalam. علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Recite in the name of your Lord, the one who created. And he left it open because he created everything. You fill in the blank. Everything that you know and don't. He created, then he mentions that he created man specifically, the subject of this letter, me and you. From a simple clot of blood, insignificant, invisible to the naked eye. Recite, and your Lord is the most generous of all the blessings that you know and don't. He gave you everything you have of life and enjoyment and family and shelter and sustenance and food and drink. And on top of that, He's giving you the way to succeed, the way to more, the way to be happy here and hereafter, because He is the most generous. Because no one can outdo Him in giving. No one can outdo Him in mercy or benevolence, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who taught the use of the pen, all the sciences and all disciplines of knowledge, everything that you have of knowledge on top of the blessings, He taught that. The origin of that knowledge was Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He taught man that which he did not know. He's giving you this revelation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a conduit of this letter to the rest of mankind, me and you. What you were seeking in the first place. And as suddenly as He appeared, the man disappeared. The end of the first revelation. Five short verses that encompasses these meanings that we mentioned and so much more. And that's it. This was the end of the first revelation. And naturally, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was surprised. This was a supernatural occurrence, no doubt. The man squeezed him three times to the point that he thought he would die, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he could tell that this was not normal, and the man, just as suddenly as he appeared, he disappeared. So he leaves the mountain. He leaves the cave and he rushes the distance a couple of miles back to Mecca. And as Aisha says, he rushes back to Mecca, يَرْتَجِفُ فُؤَادُهُ, and his heart was shaking. He was uncomfortable, he was afraid, he was confused. This isn't what he expected. He wasn't seeking to be the messenger of Allah. He wasn't seeking divine inspiration or revelation. He was trying to understand the world around him. He was trying to contemplate about that justice. He was trying to find his Lord, but he never expected to be the Messenger of Allah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was shocked and afraid as anyone would be. And the first place that he went to was his home in Mecca to his wife Khadija. And this is very significant because his number one to go to person, his parents had passed long ago. And his grandfather took care of him and sheltered him for a few years and he passed as well. And his to go to person for everything that he needed for the last 32 years was his uncle Abu Talib. He's the one who helped him get married and he's the one who he saw his advice when he wanted to go to business and so on and so forth. But now, with this huge occurrence, with this supernatural event, the supernatural fear that he was feeling, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the number one place that he went to in the first place was where? Home to his wife Khadija. And there he went to her and he said to her, he related to her what just happened, she seen the state of fear that he was in, the discomfort, and he told her, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to cover him up, to protect him. He was afraid. He was shivering. And he tells her, لَقَدْ خَشِيتُ عَلَى نَفْسِي. I'm afraid for myself. I think I'm losing it. What other conclusion is there? There's no other explanation. That man didn't say the Messenger of Allah. He didn't say this is revelation. He didn't say this is Quran. He said, recite in the name of your Lord, the one who created. Created man from a cloud of blood. Recite, and your Lord is the most generous. He has taught man the use of the pen, or by the pen, all knowledges. He taught man that which he did not know. Is there anything about being the Messenger of Allah? Is there anything about the mission? Is there anything more about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala other than that? He's the Lord and the Creator, the most generous. It stops there. So he rushes back and he is afraid and he tells her, I'm afraid I'm losing it. That's what I think just happened, that I'm literally losing my mind. And she tells him something very significant. And this is why he went back to her. He went home, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She tells him, Kalla wallahi, no way. It's not possible that this is what's happening, that you're losing your mind, that you are going crazy, that you're afflicted by some spirits or some jinn or something. That's not what is happening. No way, I swear by Allah, this is not what it is. And she told him the reason. She told him why she was so sure of that, that she swore on it. And she tells him, فَوَاللَّهِ لَا يُخْذِيكَ اللَّهُ أَبَدًا. Allah would never do that to you. He would never decree this to be the unraveling at your life after 40 years of honesty and trustworthiness and benevolence to everyone around you. She says, Wallahi, Allah will never do that for you, to you. Wallahi, innaka latasil al-rahim, wa tasdiq al-hadith, wa tahmil al-kalb, wa taksib al-ma'adum, wa tuqri al-dayf, wa tu'inu ala nawayib al-haq. Because by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all that you do is keep the ties of kinship and speak the most truthful of speech. He's a Sadiq al-Amin for 40 years. The truthful, the trustworthy. That was his nickname. The truthful, the trustworthy. It wasn't just something on his resume. That's what people called him by. So you keep the ties of kinship, and you speak the, you say the most truthful of speech, and you help the needy, and you honor the guests, and you are constantly aiding and supporting all forms of good. She said nothing about his worship, nothing about fasting or prayer, because the number one, even though these things are important and significant, the number one indication of righteousness is how we are to other people. What do the closest people know about us and how we are, how our manners are, how we deal with others? The reasons she cited for no way that he's losing it, there's no way that this is madness, this is something else, we don't know what yet. But Allah will never do that to you because you keep the ties of kinship, because you're honest, because you're kind, because you're helpful, because you are constantly aiding and supporting all means of good towards others. And there's no way that someone like that will be rewarded or see any result for their actions or their way of life except good from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they do it sincerely for his sake. So she tells him there's no way, and she was the one who suggested that they go to her cousin, Waraka ibn Nawfal. And just as a side point, quickly, Waraka was an elderly man who was above 80 years old at this time, and And he was someone who spent his whole life looking for the truth. And he had left the pagan ways of the Meccan society. He no longer worshipped idols. He didn't engage in their festivals or their worships or their rituals. And he had come to the conclusion of Christianity. And some scholars say it was a mix between Christianity and Judaism because he also knew Hebrew. And he would study the books. So she chose to take him there. Not to any of the leaders of Quraysh, not to the many soothsayers and magicians that they had that they would seek counsel with. And this is from her wisdom and her intellect as a woman and as a wife, that she knew this was something else, that these people couldn't help here. And she here, herself, not believing in these things, rejecting these things as any sound mind would, idols of stone and wood, that are not able to aid themselves, that have no form of communication with man, and all of these things that were part of his life already, so I said that he did not believe in these things. She knew that he did not engage in these things, he did not believe in them, this wasn't his way of life. So there's no way that the answer or the resolution of what he's going through at this time would be in any of those things, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So she chose to take him to Waraq ibn Nawfal, and once again he was a Christian who studied previous scriptures, and she said, tell him your story, say what happened, the same way you told me. So he tells Waraq sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the occurrence in Ghaqara, the cave of Qara. And he tells him, he responds to him, Waraqa, saying, هَذَا مُوسَى الَّذِي أُنزِلَ عَلَى مُوسَى عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. This is the same keeper of secrets. This is the same spirit, the same angel that descended upon Moses, peace be upon him. This is scripture. This is revelation. He's the first one to confirm for him that this is revelation. The same revelation that was revealed upon Moses and the previous prophets. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like the entirety of the Meccan society, with the exception of people like Waraqa, who you can count on your hands, did not know about revelation. They had no concept of prophethood in their upbringing, or the mythology, or their legends. They didn't believe in these people. They barely knew their names from the other societies and the other groups of people that lived in Arabia. So the names themselves may have been slightly familiar, but the stories, the concept of revelation of Jibreel alayhi salam descending upon people was foreign to them. So now this is the first piece of big news, the first confirmation that Waraqa gives him, that this is revelation from the same line of revelation that has occurred to prophets since the beginning of time. But it's not the most shocking. And it isn't the first thing to drive a reaction from him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next thing he tells him is more significant to him at that time. He tells him, Waraqa says, يَا لَيْتَنِي فِيهَا جَدْعًا يَا لَيْتَنِي أَكُونُ حَيًّا. I wish I was young. I wish I was a young man. He's over 80 years old at this time. He's going to die a few days after this action, before even the second revelation, before the commissioning of the Prophet Muhammad as a prophet, before he's given his mission by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's saying, I wish I was young. I wish I could be alive. What for? حِنَا يُخْرِجُكَ قَوْمُكَ. The day that your people kick you out. I wish I could be a young man alive on the day that they cast you out in exile. And this was what was too much to handle. 40 years of the Sadiq al-Amin, the truthful, trustworthy. 40 years of exactly what Khadija said, and no one denies it. Even after his prophethood, no one denied it. Of his enemies, keeping the ties of kinship, being honest, doing his best to be a benevolent member of society, not seeking anything in return, never claiming a mission, never preaching, just doing his best to be a good human being, sincerely helping others, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now he's hearing from Waraqa, I wish I was young and alive the day they kick you out. So he told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this was what was too much for him to bear. أَمُخْرِجِي يَهُمْ. They're going to kick me out. I will be cast out of the society. I'm going to be exiled from Mecca, my birthplace and the birthplace of generations past. Nowhere else is home. Nowhere else is family. Why would they kick me out after all of this? And he told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no man, no messenger has come before with such a mission except he was made an enemy. This is the way things are done. This is the methodology of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the test of life. Because your mission, your revelation will be revolutionary. And some people don't want to be fixed. Some people benefit from the status quo. Some people, their bread and butter is in the oppression and the slavery and the mindless bloodshed. And sadly, a lot of these people are in charge. So they will do their best to make sure your mission does not succeed. They will turn the others against you. This is the explanation of what he's saying. No man has come, ever, no mission, no prophet has come with what you're about to come with. There's more coming. He knows from reading the previous scriptures, except that he was laid in heaven. And then he says, and if I reach that day, if Allah gives me the length of life, I will give you such support and victory and help. I'll be there for you if I can. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed that he wouldn't reach that day. Waraka died a few days after this. But he's confirming to the Messenger of Allah what this is, revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A mission, a revolution to come. Difficulties and strife. Struggling to make sure it succeeds to fulfill the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are the Messenger of Allah. The first mission to tell him that was a Christian. Waraka. And the first two to support him came from outside. His wife and this her cousin, Waraka. He himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not have that confidence. He did not have that support within himself yet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now he is accepting of it. And he is willing to take it on. And he wants to hear more. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not reveal anything immediately. As Aisha says, continuing the story, فَالْقَطَعَ الْوَحْيِ. Revelation stopped here. And the scholars of history did different. Did it stop for a few days or a few weeks or even a few months? But either way, it stopped for a period of time that he did not expect. So now he hears, you are a messenger of Allah. This is revelation. There will be a revolution. You will be cast out. There will be difficulty. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to continue revealing to you. And he wants to seek him, but nothing comes. And he was distraught by this. He was hurt. Because he believed all of it. It was confirmed to him by Waraka. And now nothing more is being revealed. He goes back to Hira and there is no angel. There is no man. There is no revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This hurts him. Would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forsake him after now he believes all of this and he's sure that this is what it is? But there's a lesson here, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, and that is that this revelation, this mission, there's difficulty in it, as Waraka said. It's a long struggle. It's a marathon, not a sprint. And no one can do that except if they are willing, if they actively, sincerely seek it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no other reason. So he had to, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is developing in him that want for it, that desire for it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to say in the next revelation, إِنَّا سَنُلْقِ عَلَيْكَ قَوْلًا ثَقِيلًا. We're going to reveal to you a very heavy word, a very heavy speech, duties and obligations, struggle, cutting ties that you formed, forming new ones with people that are foreign to you, giving when difficult, when giving is difficult, withholding when withholding is difficult. No one can take that on, no one can force that upon themselves except lovingly and willingly for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's something that you nurture, it doesn't happen overnight. It's not like the flip of a switch or the press of a button. And it's only done by recognizing who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, His benevolence, His mercy, His goodwill, His loving compassion that is outmatched by none. And only then with that perspective do the commands and prohibitions make sense. Can they be taken willingly? Can they be upheld with love and sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So some time passes, and it's also mentioned in narration that every time he would go there and not find the angel, he'd feel sad, but then he would hear a voice telling him, you are the messenger of Allah, and I am Gabriel the archangel, just as Waraka told you. And then one of those days when he was going to the mountain seeking this revelation, he hears a voice call out to him, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says, I looked up, I looked to my right and to my left, and I saw nothing. And behind me, and there was nothing. And in front of me, there was nothing. And he hears the voice again, Ya Muhammad, so now he thinks to look up, and he says, I see the archangel Gabriel sitting on a chair that fills the heavens and the earth. And everywhere I looked at the horizon was him. His form filled my entire vision, telling him, you are the messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so he ran home, saying, Zammiluni, Zammiluni, Dathiruni, Dathiruni, once again to Khadija, to his wife and his number one support system, and the place where he found confidence when he couldn't find it in himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his wife Khadija, and she covered him, she protected him, and there the revelation came to him, Ya ayyuhal mudathir, kun fa'anthir. O you who is covered up in garments, stand up and mourn. Begin this mission. Get out of your comfort zone. There is no time to rest. And from then on, you wouldn't rest until the end of his life. Making sure that this message reached the young and the old, the Arab and the non-Arab, the rich and the poor, the free and the slave. And when people would tell him to rest, like his wife Khadija, he would tell her, the time for sleep has passed. He is now confident in himself, confident in his mission. He knows this is revelation and the miracles to follow and the struggles to follow, as we'll hear, inshallah, over the next few lectures. There's more to say, and the period of da'wah began secretly and then in public. But of course, this is just a brief. Hopefully, we can take to heart some of these lessons. We can be encouraged at least to read this story in full length with a sincere, open heart and open mind. أقول قولي هذا استغفر الله لي ولكم سبحانه وتعالى وبحمده أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته